Were you worried about Richard at some points in his life?
Oh, you mean when he was on his gurney, almost dead, that kind of story? Yeah, oh yeah. Many times.
I wasn't worried at all. I don't know.
I spent a lot of time with Richard alone in the city. He would come up and have dinner with Andrew and I, and Richard and I would go walking through the streets of Manhattan. And there were many times I was worried about Richard. It had nothing to do with his performances, but as a friend,
sometimes I did, very worried about him.
Yeah.
Yeah, sometimes.
But Richard, were you worried about where your life was heading at one point?
No.
Should you have been?
Well, yeah, but my life was unmanageable, but I didn't care. That's a drug addict, an alcoholic. I'm not boasting about this, but somehow, since the arts, my upbringing, my parents, my father died. He never saw me perform. My mother had mental illness. My brother was gone in the village reading, you know, Ginsberg poems. My sister eloped when I was 12. So I was stuck with my mom, poor thing. And I was like tethered to, like a Chagall, but tethered to zero. So I was left to my own devices. And you asked me if I was ever worried about...
What was going to happen to you?
Oh, the one thing that I... Thanks. I do that a lot now, by the way. What did you say again? Oh, was I worried? Somehow I said, the arts are my family. You know, all the icons, you know, all the Fred Neil Folky, you know, Miles, you name it, you know, Keith Jarrett and, the Stones and, you know, all the greats of the greats. So my house was filled with these pictures in it, but instead of family, it was these icons. And, but when I knew that I was way out of control, because I had good friends telling me, you know, you're gonna die. Literally, I stopped stand-up for 3 years at a peak area time in my life where I, you know, really sacrificed a tremendous amount of money. But I said, if I go on stage this way, my career is over, and then I have nothing. So, on one hand, I was smart enough to know that, on the other, but I still wasn't smart enough to bottom until I finally did, and I gave up.
So, why do you think the arts, in effect, were your way out? It gave you some kind of an anchor, gave you something.
Well, you know, when I was a kid, David Brenner, who passed away, was one of my best friends. It was a tough year for a lot of us. And comics like Joan, David, and Robin, and the list is endless. But David was a star when I met him when I was like 22, and I was at his East Side apartment, brownstone, and everything. Let's say he had a microphone. This microphone was used by Thomas Edison in 18. I said, how much? What's the difference? He didn't want to tell me. But everything was like, everything. You know, everything was valuable because he had the money. And I was living in a dump after dump. I was broke. And I said, how do you ever, you know, like want like a stapler that was used by in the Declaration of Independence would have been like 5 years of my rent for $110 a month. So I said, how did you do this? And he said, I bought this stuff with jokes. That was like in 71 or 70. So when I was holed up in my house with crystal meth for about 8 or 9 days and really on my way out, I was looking in the mirror and I just looked, you know, like a horror show. And I said to myself, I remembered this thought. I said, I had some really beautiful things. I said, I bought this house with jokes. And I'm going to put this shit up my nose and ruin it all. So I called two friends and they took me to the hospital and that was it. And the doctor says, what are you doing? I said, I'm killing myself, but it's over. No mas. So that joke line and other things, but that joke line really, that stuck in my craw because I remembered that I'm doing something so pitiful, you know, so.